Well, there's 2 years difference in third grade. And I taught Bobby 1 year, too. And they went to the grade school there at Clinchburg all those years. Then when it came time for Frankie to go to high school, I should have told about boarding away for myself to go to high school, shouldn't I?
Go ahead.
There was no high school where I lived, and my father got board for me at Clinchburg. Paid $5 a month board. A car took a lot of us to Saltwell High School because there's no high school there in Clinchburg. And we paid $5 a month tuition. $3 a month for a car to ride in, that's $13 a month. And I graduated in 1927. Then my father sent me to Radford College for 1 year, 1927-1928. Then I came back and taught my first school. I made $440 for the year, $55 a month, $440 a year. Then after I taught that school, I started going to Emory during the summer months.
Paying your own way?
Paying my own way. I'd teach in the winter and go walk up to Montgomery's and ride with them to Emory and Henry College till I got my degree. Then I taught school for several years, a total of 42 years. But one night we were sitting in the living room. My son had gone to Virginia Tech. And he had a car for the last 2 years up there, and he came in one night, and he brought this girl with him. She came in, and she says, well, says, I'm your daughter-in-law. And my husband grabbed her and set her on his lap, says, I've always wanted a daughter, now I have one. I got up and ran to the kitchen, was crying, that I lost my son. In a few minutes, he came in and he says, dry that up. You got married and so did he. He had just as much right to get married as you did. I said, well, I'm just losing my son. We came back in and sat down, talked for a while, and it was all better, you know. And I don't know what they did then. What did they do? Do you remember?
They got away, he finished school and they went to Germany.
Went to Germany for 3.5 years. But little Frankie was already born. He was born at Radford. And they called us and told us one morning that we had a grandson. It was on Thanksgiving, I think. Mm-hmm. We quit everything and drove to Radford to see that grandson that day and came back. And then my son and his wife took the little boy and went to Germany for 3.5 years. And they wanted us to visit them in Germany. We went to down to Bristol to the airport and checked in to see what it's going to cost us. And we found out it's going to cost us $1,400. And that was a lot of money at that time.
1958-59.
Stamps were a penny then, I think. And we both decided that we'd better save that $1,400. And by then, Frank said, they'll need a place to live in when they get back. And we bought, made the down payment in Lincolnshire with that money instead of going to Germany. Later I regretted that we could have done maybe both, gone to Germany and given them the money too. So they lived on Lincolnshire for several years. We visited them there all the time.
What do you remember most about your grandkids coming to visit during the summer?
Well, during the summer months, the two older grandchildren, Kim and Frankie, would come down and stay 2 weeks with us. We thought that was heaven on earth, to have those two children with us. I worked with Kimberly, and he would take Frankie and go places.
That's right.
And he took him places that I never knew about until later. One place was Tumbling Creek, far, far away. think they rode a horse, Tumbling Creek. And he told me later about taking Frankie to Tumbling Creek. But there were many places that he took him. And I would take you to my grandmother's and my aunt's and around about there. And it wasn't long until you had a boyfriend.
Who was my first boyfriend?
I don't remember.
Remember when we used to go down to the golf course and Jimmy, I can't remember his last name, you knew him.
Mommy.
Who was the guy with the, not the undertaker, but
Mommy.
From the funeral home? What was that guy's name, David? In Saltville that I thought was so cute. So good.
Yes, it's David Henderson.
Henderson, that's
Mommy.
Right.
Yeah.
Hold
Mommy.
On. Okay. Tell some of those stories, like when I was Tatum's age and you said I threw a shoe at her, at you, I threw a shoe at you.
Yeah.
Tell some of the stories when I was like 2 and 3 and 4.
Yeah.
Yeah,
you would get angry with me if I didn't want you to do things you wanted to do. You threw a shoe at me one day and hit me. But that was just like a child. And we would get out in the yard and play croquet, play different games out in the yard, and we had cousins that came around and
did things.
Yeah, and did things together too.
Okay.
On Lincolnshire Street.
That's right. What we'll do here is say, okay, guest arrived. We had to turn the camera off. We are now going to pick back up with, you had hoped that the $1,400, you could have gone to Germany and also given the money to Janet Frank for a house. So go ahead and continue there.
Well, money was scarce in those days. I was teaching. My granddaddy was working, but wages were low. We didn't have much money. We just lived from month to month.
Well, how come I always thought you guys were rich?
I don't know where that idea came from, but you were badly wrong. There were no rich people around us. Now, my sister and I thought that Mr. Steele, our school board member, was rich. He had a big farm, but so did my father. My father had 2 or 3 farms and tenant houses. He had big farms too. But we figured Mr. Steele, he just had one child. And she was a friend of my sister Lillian. But they weren't rich. And my father thought that we were wrong in thinking he was rich. And my father had 4 son-in-laws. Ellis DeBusk, Lynn McAllister, Clarence Clover, and Frank Grace. But he thought Ellis DeBusk and Lynn McAllister were going to be rich people. But however, he didn't think about Frank Grace and Clarence Crabtree. That's a fact. But he liked them. And they visited him, but they were kind of skittish of him, you know. They knew that they could get on better terms with my mother than they could with my father.
What did Granddad do for a living?
He had a slaughterhouse. The only one in the country. Not another person nowhere around. And on Friday morning, he killed his bees. He had a slaughterhouse. And he had helpers, you know, workmen. And one of them was a black man from cross country to Emory. He helped him every Friday. And killed those bees on Friday morning. And this black man was named Andy Jackson. And he was there, and when my father went to eat lunch every day, Andy would come, he'd bring Andy too. And Andy'd get his plate filled and go to the kitchen to eat. He'd say, Andy, you aren't going to do that. You're going to sit down at this table with the rest of us and eat. He was very good to the black people, helped them along. He took beef to Emory on Friday afternoon. Saturday morning, he got his hack, which was pulled by 2 horses. And you know what a hack is? Well, it was covered wagon like, and you could roll the sides up and the back, and he had a beef rack in there that he put his beef. You see, he cut up his beef on Friday and put it in there ready to sell. And he went to Smoky Row, Saltville, Parable, Ellison Gap, sold beef. And many of them were credit, had the credit. They didn't have money to pay for their beef. But it's the only way they had of getting fresh meat, no other way. Then on Saturday, that was Saturday, he peddled beef to Saltville. Sunday morning, every Sunday morning, he went to see his mother first. Never missed a Sunday morning, go see his mother. He'd walk up there. He had four horses, but a lot of times he would walk up there. And then he'd come back, and we had a sinkhole up on the hill above our house. And he would take his book where he had written down his customers and what they owed him, and he'd go over that and unravel all that, you see, and have it fresh looking for the next weekend. I told you about the time that we had to ask him if we could go places. Mm-mm. And I had a boyfriend named Little Rob Henderson.
Yeah, you told me about that.
Yeah. Well, when we went to parties, everybody in the valley went. We would go up to Bruce Gallagher's, walk up there. Bruce had a fiddle, or I think it was a fiddle, banjo or something. He made the music. And there was several of them. Dane, his sister, and I were in the same grade and best of friends. And he'd pick and sing for us. Then that whole crowd, every young boy and every young girl, that's the only way we'd go. They won't let us go unless everybody was going, you know. We'd be disgraced. You couldn't go alone anywhere. So we'd all walk back down the valley. Well, on Sunday morning, we went to church. Sunday afternoon, we went to Sunday school. My parents belonged to the Baptists. But when the Methodists started preaching, the Methodists had six churches on their charge. It's called a Keywood charge. And they preached at our place on Sunday afternoons. First Sunday of every month, the Baptists preached. They came Saturday morning, preached Saturday morning, spent the night at my parents' home, preached on Sunday morning. Then when the Methodists came along, Mary Lou was the first one to join the Methodist church. And I played the organ at the church. And John Grady was the superintendent of Sunday school. And he'd have to ask me and beg me every Sunday because I was afraid he wasn't doing right by playing. I'd had music lessons. I walked to Gummer's and took music piano lessons. And I was sitting at playing at the organ. I was on the stool one night. And Preacher Graybill, we call them preachers, Preacher Graybill was holding a revival. And he called for people to come up to the altar bench. And Leon and Hazel went up. And he left the altar and came over to me. I was sitting on the stool. He says, "Don't you want to join the church with your two sisters?" And I got up off the stool and over, and we all three joined. Uncle Leo Fern, everybody called him Uncle Leo, but I think he was related to my mother. He fought the Civil War. And so did Frank's grandfather, Bob Grace. Well, he was at church, and he had a long white beard down to here. Lived up the holler just above my parents' home. And he walked with a cane. And on Sunday Sundays at church, he'd put that cane down on the floor, and everybody knew what was coming. He put that cane on, and everybody started shouting. He would shout, and people were shouting in those days and testifying. That's out, you know.
What year was that? Do you remember? About what year?
Well, it was way back before I was ever married. That's back in the
20s?
Yeah, I'd say 29, 30, something like that. And my father had this farm, and we went to the farm and worked, all of us. My sisters and I would, and Mama cook hot lunch, and we'd carry it to the fields to them. Then we stayed that afternoon and helped pull tomatoes, corn, tobacco, whatever. We had a cane patch. You know what a cane patch is?
Sugar cane?
Yeah, to make molasses. And we'd strip that cane and cut it off and cut the top off. And we stripped all the blades down, you know, laid them in a pile. And I think we had a waterway of washing, and we had a cane mill. It was called a cane mill. We put that cane juice in that mill. My father has this, we had this great long trough of thing, put that thing on, and you'd build a fire under there. And you'd have to keep skimming it, you know, keep the top off, throw it away. And we'd usually do that at night.
So was that a money maker at
that
time?
Yeah, he sold molasses. Uh-huh. We ate molasses, and so did he sell molasses. And we'd make it at night, be a big crowd around, you know. That was our party. Well, let's go and talk about going to church. We'd go to church on Saturday night, and Hazel and I want to sit by a window. So the boys would come to the windows and talk to us, you know.
During church? Not my grandmother.
We'd sit at that window, and the boys come along. They'd just say hello, a few words, you know. And I remember one night that Hazel and I were sitting in the back. And my father's up front, my mother, too. They sat up in the front seat. He got up, politely came back to the back of the church, said, "Come with me, both of you." And he took us up to the front. He wouldn't let us sit by the window where the boys could come and smile at us. We didn't do much courting. We weren't allowed to. Well, I told you about going away to college.
Uh-huh.
I think I told you about that.
I want you to tell me a little bit about how schools were when you were teaching and discipline and what was expected of the kids.
Well, I taught down at Bristol one time in a, yeah, we used switches. at the place was called Three Springs, and there were seven grades there. And I boarded at a house called Pettyjohn's, and there were two girls that really loved me. There was no doubt about it. I brought them home with me to spend the weekend, and I got along fine down there. The superintendent told me that if I would take that school that year, that he would place me at home the next year, because I hadn't applied, you know, and he needed a teacher. Mm-hmm. So that's what he did. And at home, I taught the first, second, and third grade. Then there was another teacher for fourth and fifth grade, another one for sixth and seventh. Then when you went to high school, we had high school at Lockwood Chapel at one time. But when it became credited, it lost. It couldn't certify.
We went to that school and visited sometime, didn't
we?
It was in Saltville?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And so we went to, Hazel and I went to Saltville High School. She boarded with Rob Henderson, my mother's nephew. And said she said she worked like a dog. But I boarded at Lee Hees. And that was Frank's and my father's niece. I told you about what it cost us to go.
Mm-hmm. Tell me about when you were teaching yourself.
Well, I thought I was on top of the world. I was making, first year taught, I told you I made $440.
Right.
It was $55 one. We only taught 8 months.
Now, let's go 42 years later. What were you making a year?
I was making about $1,500 a year.
When you quit?
When I quit, I was making...
$15,000 a year, maybe?
Close to it, yes. It progressed in that stage. And
What was the year you stopped teaching?
72.
So in 72, you could have been making more than that.
Uh-huh. Well, Washington County didn't pay much in, but I had a sick spell, and I had to go to Richmond. And I had a rockage in my leg, went to Richmond. First went to Abingdon for 2 weeks, went to Richmond for a month, 6 weeks. So I decided that I'd quit teaching because of my illness. My principal came to my home, begging me not to retire. He says, take a leave of absence, then I can take you back next year. But if you retire, I can't take you back. I made a mistake there. I should have gone on and taught. The other 8 years made me 50. But I substituted for many, many years. And in my early days teaching, we did switch. We'd send out and get switches. Everybody did. We had that form of discipline, and we had discipline too.
Didn't have any problem with the kids.
No, they didn't talk back to you, and they didn't fight. And you remember this little bell?
Mm-hmm.
Have I told you about that?
Tell me about it again.
This little bell was one that belonged. You see, four of us girls taught school, and Mary Lou had this bell. And when she quit teaching, I was teaching, she gave it to me. And the way we used it, we didn't have a bell for it. And when it, at 9 o'clock, we rang that bell and everybody on the playground came in. We read the Bible, prayed the Lord's Prayer, and we called the roll, and the children would answer with a Bible verse.
What do you think about today with all the freedom of speech and stuff like that being taken out because people say, well, you're not teaching my kids the Bible or politics in school?
Well, I do think there should be discipline in the classroom. Without it, you cannot teach the lessons. And you need some form of discipline. I don't believe in being brutal to a child, but I believe in correcting them.
What about teaching them the Bible in school without parental permission?
We had a Bible teacher that came to our school and preach the Bible in our classroom. Well, when they threw that out, she would come up to the schoolhouse and get the children, different grades at different times, go down to the foot of the hill. There was a Nazarene church down there. Take them down there and teach them the Bible. We weren't even allowed to pray the Lord's Prayer. We couldn't say the Pledge of Allegiance because it had God in it. Everything about God was taken away. Then what?
Let's talk a little bit about your grandchildren. I'm going to ask you your fondest memory of each one.
Yes.
Okay, let's start with the oldest, Frank the third.
My son had married. We went through that.
Mm-hmm.
Well, on Thanksgiving Day, I believe, got a call. They were living in Radford. They called us that morning. We had a grandson. We quit everything and drove up there. I think we had, I don't know whether they had a car now, I don't know if they had a truck. Because my father had the only truck in the whole valley. And he got that so he peddled his beef with the hack, without the hack. We went up there and spent the day, went back home. We thought we were elected, having a grandson. We talked and talked about it. Then they came and visited us and stayed a few weeks.
Well, your grandson is now 34. Out of all the 34 years, what's the one incident or the one thing he did that really stands out in your mind?
I don't know. I guess it was when he started going places with my husband. They go off to places I didn't know where they were going. And he took him to many places, such as Tumbling Creek, and the cove, Tumbling Cove, a place that I would have objected to because I was afraid for him to go up in there. It was a lonely place, mountainous, and I was afraid. After they came back home, he told me where they'd been. And I'm not sure if they may have ridden a horse. They rode horses. Your dad and your uncle would go out in the fields and catch a horse and ride him. And my father told them not to do that. It was dangerous. But they went one time and got on two horses that were wild. And he did paddle them for that because it was a risk of their lives, you know. Mm-hmm. Horses have to be tamed for a bridle and a saddle. He had four horses. One of them was named Lady. And Hazel and I got on those horses. And we get to ride to work a lot of time, and we lope You know what lope is?
Mm-hmm.
Cantering the horses. They'd gallop. And we'd switch them a little bit, and they would gallop. We had saddles on them, you know. Now, Mary Lou had to ride a side saddle, but we got to ride a straddle.
Well, let's move on to the grandchild number two.
Grandchild number two, which was you.
That's right.
My son joined the Army. When he was got through tech, he called us and told us what he'd done. He'd joined the Army. He says, "Now, Mother, all my friends have gone, and I want to be a true American, and I'm going too." It nearly broke my heart, but there was nothing I could do. So they went to Germany, stayed there 3.5 years, and came back home. And we gave them money to place down payment on their home in Lincolnshire. And we visited Lincolnshire many times. We knew Jim Horn and his family. I have some pictures that he drew and painted that he gave to me. They were good friends of your parents, and they were friends of ours too. And after so long a time, when they got in shape, then they left Lincolnshire and came to Annandale and bought a better place. And all the families here came about the same time, same ages and number of children, and have lived here since. And I've been coming every year since they've been up here.
What's the one thing you remember about me? If you had to tell one story about Kim, what would it be?
Time she threw a shoe at me. And the time that her mother was trying to wean her from the bottle. She was all bottom. And Kim was crying so, and I couldn't take it. And I knew where the bottle was hidden. I went and got it and gave it to her. Put milk in it and gave it to her. And her mother had a fit on me because she was trying to wreck her from the bottle.
So why'd you do it?
Because you were wanting it, and I loved you, and I thought you ought to have it. And I gave it to you. And I petted you just like you belonged to me. I carried you to my aunts, both my aunts, my uncles, everywhere. I said, "This is mine. This is my granddaughter. I want you to see her." I introduced you to everybody coming and going, even boyfriends, trying to get a boyfriend down there.
What about Jessica? Jessica's number three. What do you remember about Jessica?
Let's see. She was different altogether. She was not she's not as close to me as Kim was. You just didn't get that close, and Frank didn't think so either. And they didn't live near us then. He was in the Air Force, I believe, and they were traveling. I didn't see much of her. But Julie and Jill were real close to me. And Jill would say, "Grandmother, I'm Jill Catherine. I'm your granddaughter. I'm Jill Catherine."
Didn't they move to like Abington when Jill and Julie came around? So they grew up smaller with you?
Yeah, and their other grandparents lived in Abington. They would visit them, you know. And then when Jason came along, he was our second grandson. And he was quite different, but I think he loved us too. And Frank was fond of him because he liked the boy too, you know. That's two grandsons we had.
What about Shannon? She was the third from your first son.
Yeah, I remember Shannon. We would go places, and we'd be in the car with Janet and all of them. Janet would be smoking a cigarette. I remember yet Shannon begging her mother to throw that cigarette out the window and not smoke. I'll always remember that.
What was Granddad's nickname for Shannon? Do you remember that?
Mommy.
Wasn't it Shanny?
Shanny, and didn't he call her Trouble or?
Troublemaker.
No. Dad, what was Granddad's nickname for Shannon?
Dad.
Do you remember?